Okay, welcome to Upgrade Week 3. This is just little bits and pieces of stuff that we learned that, you know, we captured on the board electronically. This isn't the entire thing. Bits and pieces, especially the science and the mathematics. Next slide. All right, I always like to warm up, so this was Week 3, Day 1. And start with some fairly simple math. This is all chapters 1 to, 1 to 2. So we should all be well past that. Let's just animate this a little bit here. Right here was the questions that I gave you. You gotta practice this stuff, all right? And use your red cheat sheet, well, reference notes if you want, if you need them. But we should be well beyond this stuff now. Next slide. And here's the first one. 24 times 13. Watch this. I'm going to draw it. I'm going to make 13 packets of 24 things. That's what it means. 24 times 13 technically means you've got 13 bunches of 24. Here you go. You want me to draw them for you? Look, I'm going to draw a package of 24 things. This is the way it used to be done 3,000 years ago. You just throw pebbles in the sand and you'd make 24 packets of 30. Well, let's speed it up. There's one packet. Here's another packet. That makes two packets of 24. Here comes a third. Here comes a fourth. We're going to make 13 packets of 24 and then add them all up. You could do that if you want. It's kind of time consuming. Why don't we just learn the correct way to, well, the more expedient way to multiply, right? This way here is not incorrect, but there are more efficient ways to do it. So that's why we learn how to do multiplying 24 times 13. Okay, here's that last packet coming at you, 24 times 13. But of course, your teachers and I teach you how to do it this way. Where is it? 24 times 13. Oh, okay. Next slide. Here's the way we teach you how to do it. Okay. Oh, another way you could do it too is just to add, animate. You could just add 24 13 times. Okay, so you could do that too. Because multiplying really just is repeated addition. So you could take 13 24s added together. And as long as you're really good at adding a whole bunch of stuff, computers are good at that. But let's use the proper way of multiplying on the left there. Okay? So that should be old news. Carry on, next slide. Okay, here's dividing. Dividing is really repeated subtraction. Alright? We just finished saying that multiply is repeated addition. Dividing is really how many ways can you take away a number. So let's animate this. Let's say you've got something like 312 divided by 13. That's what the left one says. It doesn't say 13 divided by 312. It says 312 divided by 13. All right? They all say that. Here's how you do the calculation on the left coming at you in purple there. Sort of speaks for itself. I hope you know how to do that. I'm not going to explain that this time around. But notice that there's three ways to show 312 divided by 13. Make sure you know what is doing the dividing. Next slide. And here's some multiplying, right? This is still from the warm-up. Multiplying. Don't have a spell check here, but there you go. 1/5 times 1/2, or 1/2 times 1/5. Well, let's just animate it. I'll do it in chocolate bars. You know, I like the chocolate bars. Here's half of a chocolate bar. I hope you agree that one thing broken into two parts is called half. Then I'm going to chop it into fifths. You got to pretend those are all nice and even. So if you take things that are broken into halves and break them into fifths, you've actually broke them into tenths. There's now 10 chunks there. They're smaller chunks, but there's 10 chunks of chocolate. So if you had 1/2, isn't that the same as having 5/10? So 1/2 is 5/10, but you've only got 1/5 of 5/10. So out of those 5 different chunks, we've only got 1 chunk out of 5 of the 1 chunk out of 2. It's the same as saying you got 1 chunk out of 10. Okay? Or just learn the proper way to do it. Go straight across the top. Straight across the bottom. 1 times 1 is 1. 2 times 5 is 10 in the bottom. Okay, so there's the idea behind it. See if you can follow this slide. And use your reference notes if you want. You're perfectly allowed to do that. Next slide. Let's do some multiplying. Alright, multiplying decimals. This is up at multiplying decimals is up at chapter 7. So this is chapter 7. Now, not all of you are there yet, but it's not that difficult if you understand how to multiply counting numbers, like whole numbers. You know, like when you're counting sheep, you can't have a decimal sheep. But, so when you get into decimals, there's a little trick. You just pretend that there are no decimals, and then you do the math. So let's do that, enemy. So just do the multiplying like there is no decimals. And of course, you should always have a rough idea. I'm guessing 160 is about the answer. So all you do is you forget the decimal point, and you do the math, and you adjust the decimal point at the end. So here's the regular way of multiplying. Forget the decimal. Leave it alone for now. Now you play with the decimal point. All right. So since you've got counting from the right, the top number is 1 decimal point in, and the bottom number is 1 decimal point in. So you move your final answer in 2 decimal points, 2 decimal places rather, from the right. 157.17. And didn't I guess the answer should have been about 160? Right, because about 40 times about 4 should have given about 160. So having a rough idea what the answer is another good way to make sure you're not going to screw up the decimal point. Next slide. All right, so most of you should be chapter 5 at least. Some of you are already, and we handed out chapter 12 as well. That was a separate thing, graphs and charts and all that. We're 2.5 weeks into the course. You should be done pretty much chapter 5. Next slide. Okay, 2 5/8. How to convert a mixed fraction to an improper fraction. So, this was a question somebody had. If you've got 2 5/8 of something, how do you convert that into a pure fraction? Because right now it says you got 2 whole sheep. And then 5/8 of a sheep. Somebody chopped a sheep up into 8 bits and gave you 5 of them. So 2 whole chocolate bars and 5 parts of an 8-part chocolate bar. 2 5/8. What's another way to say that? If you wanted to have just pure fractions. So let's draw the pretty picture. Whoops. Here we'll animate. So here comes 2 5/8. We'll just silently animate. If you do the counting, 8/8 plus 8/8 plus 5/8 is 21/8. The secret way to do it is go the 8 times the 2 is 16 plus the 5 is 21. So you call it 21/8. So 2 8ths plus a 5, so 2 times an 8 plus 5, all divided by 8, gives you 21/8. So if you've got 21/8 of a pizza, you have 2 whole pizzas and 5/8 of a pizza. You're going to find later on that these mixed fraction numbers are annoying. You got to convert them into fractions anyways. In fact, when you do calculus, pre-calculus math with me, I cringe every time I see a mixed number. You'll find you just leave everything improper. All right, so unless you're going to be a carpenter where you use mixed numbers like 2 3/16. You know, I tend tend not to like these numbers anyways. Next slide. Next slide. I'm just showing you equivalent fractions. We're trying to show you here that 2/3 is the same as 4/6 and an 8. And I'll probably draw something here. Here it comes. Here's a chocolate bar. Your kids ate 1/3 of it, so you've got 2/3 of a chocolate bar left over. Now, if you chop a chocolate bar into half like that, look how that chocolate bar, by cutting it in half, the 2/3, half of 2/3, becomes, well, 2/3 was originally the same as 4/6, but if you chop that in half, you end up with, right, so it's the same as 4/6. So 2/3 is the same as 4/6. Exactly. Yeah. Now, the pieces are twice as small, but it's still the same amount of chocolate. But instead of saying you got 2 parts of a 3-part chocolate bar, you got 4 parts of a 6-part chocolate bar. Enough. Carry on. Okay, decimal division. All right, there's not a trick to any of these. All right, the only extra step to this is, since you do not know your 0.02 multiplication tables, or maybe you do, you want to turn it into something you do know. You do know your 2 times multiplication tables. So if you could convert that 0.02 into a 2, you might be able to handle this, because you know your 2 times tables. So that's what you're going to do. You're going to take that 0.02 and multiply it by 10, and then 10 again, because 0.02 times 10 times 10 would be 2. But you can't multiply that 0.02 times 10 without multiplying that 4.2 times 10. So you really end up turning the problem into, check out the green there below, you really end up turning the problem into how many 2s go into 420, because you just move the decimal point 2 places to the right on both of them. You pretty much just magnified the problem and made it 100 times bigger so you could solve it better. There's one way to think about it, animate. All right, so here we come. Here's the problem. How many 2/100ths go into 4 2/10? That's the correct way to say it, by the way. So you move the decimal point 2 places to the right on both of them. So you really end up with something simple like how many 2s go into 420. Then you do all that noise about carrying, dropping zeros down and stuff like that. You're going to do it all on a calculator in another week or two anyways, once you're past chapter 8. And notice you can always check your answer. You should always check your answer in the original. So we said that 4.2 divided by 0.02 is 210. So check your answer by multiplying, because the opposite of multiplying is dividing. So is 210 times 0.02 the same as 4.2? And you'll find out that it is when you move the decimal point. Okay, so next slide. And this was just a fun puzzle I gave you for science. It was a crypto puzzle. You had to sort of guess what the letters were. So you got to have a little bit of a vocabulary of science. And it worked out pretty good. When you're doing these types of puzzles, remember the most common letters in English words, at least, are the letters E, T, I, O, N, and S. So it turns out, well, we'll animate it, but it turns out that it eventually looked like this. Right, I had started you off with some letters, and the slashes there are just spaces, so you can see where I put spaces. Lots of websites do this, all right? And there was a little secret D code at the... We're trying to figure out what letter stands for what. So you had to have the sheet to do this. I don't have a copy of it to paste into here. But it eventually ended up saying, science is nothing more than the search for truth. And mathematics is blah, blah, blah. Turns out mathematics is the search for patterns. All right, so if you got that puzzle kicking about, that's what it was trying to do. Maybe we'll do more of those next time. Next slide. Let's read some more on modern astronomy. So we've done all the ancient astronomy, well, and then back to about 500 years ago with Kepler and the boys. So let's have a look at modern astronomy since, you know, the last 140, 150 years. And we looked at a guy named Herschel. He used telescopes to discover Uranus. And we looked at different types of telescopes. There's the big ones you get are made of mirrors, reflecting telescopes. They reflect light and focus it at on your eyeball there. Right? You can make really big reflecting telescopes. Right? Most people are familiar with refracting, you know, like lenses on your glasses. But you can only get so big with them. You know, maybe about 10 or 15 inches is about as big as you... Well, that's not quite true. You can only get so big, a couple feet across, and then because of the thickness of the lenses, the light doesn't get through. So the best telescopes for most purposes for looking at light are big mirrors, like dozens of feet across. And usually you'll find that optical lights telescopes are up at the top of mountains because the air won't interfere with the light coming down from the stars. Okay, next slide. So yeah, a fellow named Herschel, for example, discovered Uranus in 1781. And he was using a refracting telescope. And you've probably seen well, that's how your glasses work. But refraction bends light. Like when you see a spoon in a glass, you know how the spoon looks a little bit bent? All right, so we talked about that sort of stuff, and we saw a couple movies on it. If you weren't here, well, check out my website on the science page. Then we talked about light waves and radio waves and gamma rays, because everything around you has waves coming off it. So believe it or not, light is no different than a radio wave or a TV wave. It's just a lot higher in frequency. So whereas a radio wave might be vibrating at 98 million times a second, all right, megahertz, like on your radio, that's what the 98.3 stands for, 98 megahertz, 98 million times a second. You'll find that light is up there vibrating at billions of times a second, all right? But otherwise, there's no difference between radio and the light that your eyeball sees. In fact, our eyes see, oh, such a tiny little piece of what's going on around us. You know, if we could see below red, we could see heat. If we could sense below that, we could hear radio in our heads without needing a radio. And up higher, the higher frequencies beyond the purple are your ultraviolet. That's what gives you sunburn. You can't see it, but it's burning you. And then gamma rays and other types of rays, you know, that turn the Incredible Hulk into him in people's imaginations. Anyway, we do have other types of telescopes. We have radio telescopes as well. We don't have just visible telescopes. There are things that we are sensing in outer space that you cannot see with your eye. There's things around you right now that you can't see, but there are things that sense them. And I showed you a video on how some helicopters can see in the dark and chase criminals around and stuff like that with infrared. Next slide. Oh, okay. So we started a warm-up here, and I did them all for you on the board, mostly successfully. But what I was getting at here is you can do them the way you were taught, or there's a mental math trick to multiply two-digit numbers together. So if you've got a two-digit number times a two-digit number, it is possible to do them together in your head. All right? Let's try it. I'll show you if I don't mess it up. All right, so let's try the first one that I gave you there. And you can always pause this in YouTube and send it back 12 times. What was the question? 12 times. And this is sort of like that straw method that I showed you too last week. So you go 2 times 3 is 6. Now you cross diagonal multiply. You go 3 times a 1 is 3, and 2 times a 1 is 2, and the 3 and the 2 is 5, so you got to remember two numbers in your head. And then you go the 1 times a 1 is 1. The answer is 156. Can you do that in your head? Let's try this one. So you're going to do the two numbers on the right, the oneses. Then we're going to cross across the oneses with the tenses on the up and top bottom, top and bottom number. So there's 1 times 7 is 7. Boom, write it down. Now you got 1 times the 1 and 7 times the 1. Well, 1 and 7 is 8, so that's an 8 in the middle. Here comes the 8. See, 1 times the 1 is 1, and 7 times the 1 is 7. So 7 and 1, you got to keep some numbers in your head. You got to practice is 8. And then you got the 1 times the 1 is 8. 187. See, you can do these. Now, you might have to practice every night for a week. Let's try 17 times. What was the question? 17 times. We already did this one. 17 times 11 is 187. Oh, it's just another little trick you can do. You just add the 1 and the 7 and stick it in the middle. So 17 times 11 is 187. 23 times 11 is 253, right? 2 and 3 is 5, so you stick it in the middle. Multiplying by 11, that's that neat little trick. Add the two numbers together and stick them in the middle. Now, there may be a carry sometimes, all right? But don't worry. Yeah, you'll figure it out. All right, so let's try the next one here. Let's do 32 times 14. All right, so the ones are that, so that's obviously an 8. Now you got 3 times a 4 is 12, and then you do the other tens with the 1. So you got 3 times 4 is 12, and 2 times 1 is 2, so that makes 14. Then you got a carry 1. So 1 and 3 is, 1 times 3 rather is 4, plus the 1 you carry is 4, 48. Starting to get the idea for this, right? You can do some, being able to do this in your head is kind of handy sometimes, provided you don't mess it up. Okay, just an example. You don't have to do it this way. If you want to do it the long way, that's fine. If you're going to use a calculator in a couple weeks, well, go for that too. I don't care. You're not going to always do it the long way. Let's try these ones here. Let's animate. Animate. All right. Let's try them doing that fancy method of diagonal multiplying, I'll call it. Right, 2 times 7 is 14, then you've got 28 and 6 is 34, plus the 1 you carried is 35, carry 3, 3 times 4 is 12, 15, 54. You can do these in your head. There's a bunch of YouTube videos that do this too. It's just like I'm showing you. Actually, multiplying by 15 is pretty easy too, isn't it? Why don't you just multiply by 10 and then add half of that? Right, 24 times 15. Isn't 24 times 10 240? So 24 dimes is 240. And then 24 nickels is obviously going to be half as much. So what's 240 and 120? 360. A little bit of a trick there. So the more you practice doing simple multiplying in the head, the quicker you'll be. And you won't need a calculator all the time. And then we saw a movie about a mathemagician. Try typing that in on YouTube or a Google at mathemagician. Anyway, he was squaring numbers in his head, like 14,381 times 14,381. And it's actually not that difficult to do. You know, it might take you 2 months to practice three. Well, it might take you a year or two. And then you could be on the road making $50,000 a year like him. Just being a calculating machine. Yeah. Sounds like fun. Next slide. Okay, and if you want to practice what he was doing on that video, the mathemagician squaring numbers, that just means multiply a number by itself. There's a button on your calculator that does it. It's the X squared button. All right. So all you do is you type in a number, you hit X squared, boom, it multiplies it by itself. All right. If you still don't have a calculator that has at least 50 little different functions on it, go get one. They're $2 a Dollarama. Unless you want to do arithmetic the long way for the remainder of the course. Next slide. Okay, so let's work on our prism lessons. Don't forget, you also have chapter 12, graphs and statistics. Next slide. chapter 12. Okay, so most people are done the chapter 12, just the test to go. You can use a calculator on chapter 12. I'm not expecting you to do long math in chapter 12. So, for example, you were asked to find the mean of 3, 6, 8, 11, and 22. Well, you add them all up, and you divide by the number of numbers, 5. Answer is 10. So obviously it's got to be somewhere between 3 and 22. An average is sort of like a middle, central number. So it's got to be somewhere in the middle of the pack. And there you go. There's how you do it. Next slide, and activate. Oh, here's more dividing with decimals. Remember, the secret to this is to move the divisor decimal. So that 8.9 is called the divisor. This question says, how many 8.9s can you divide into 63.99? In other words, how many 8.9s can you take out of 63.99? Or how many 8.9s could you squeeze into a 63.99? So the secret was to turn that 8.9 into a 89. And if you move it 1 point to the right, you have to do the same for the thing that's being divided. It's called the dividend. And you end up with a very simple, there it is right there. You end up with a very simple calculation now. How many 89s go into 639.9? I hate saying 0.9. All right, let's animate this. Go. So move the decimal on the divisor, because you know how to do dividing without a decimal. Turn it into something you know how to do. There you go. And you'll end up with a funky number. Next slide. Well, actually, it won't be too bad a number. Here it comes. It ends up being 9.1. Or technically 9 and 1/10 is the correct way to say 9.1. It's just lazy to say 9 point something. We all do it, but it's not the correct way to pronounce that number. So we turn it into a simpler problem. The answer is 9.1, or 9 1/10 is more accurate way to say it. Be neat, be orderly, make sure your numbers line up. All right, so now we're on week 3, day 4. Let's do some warm-ups. These are the ones here. You can always rewind a bit in YouTube if you want. Let's next slide. Animate. So here's the 18 times 15. Isn't it really 270? 18 dimes would be 180, and then half of that would be 90. 180 and 90 is 270. You need a calculator. Do you need? Right. Anyway, there you go. One way to do it would be to draw 15 packets of 18 marbles. Or another way to do it would be to take 18 and add it to itself 15 times. Well, let's not do that. Or we could just do the proper way of doing it that we taught. Or you could do a mental math trick too. But here's the proper way you were taught. Okay. Or you could have done it mentally in your head. There's a few ways to do that we've been practicing. See, there's a way I like to do it in my head, the last little bit. I think of 18 times 15 as being 18 times 10, so 18 dimes, that's 180, and 18 nickels. Well, 18 nickels is going to be half as much as 18 dimes, so isn't it going to be 90? So isn't the answer 270? If you practice these in your head, you'll figure out your own shortcuts, and it pays off, all right? Let's do 37 times 4. 37 times 4. Animate. And you should be able to do these in your head. Isn't 37 times 4 really just 4 30s plus 4 7s?
Right.
Or you could draw a bunch of marbles in packages, and let's not do that. Or you could add 37 to itself 4 times. Let's not do that either. Why don't you just say that it's 4 bunches of 30 and 4 bunches of 7? I can do 4 30s in my head, that's 120. I can do 4 7s in my head, that's 28. I can remember 120 and 28 in my head and add them together, 148. It does take practice. Or heck, use a calculator after you're done chapter 8. Next slide, engage. Let's practice some of these. I'm getting tired of this arithmetic. It's boring, boring, boring. Engage. Are you getting the same answers? You getting the same answers? Shall we try that one again? Let's try that one again and see if you get the same answers. Okay, I'll just reanimate it here. There's the questions. See if you get the same answers. 8 20s would be 160 and 24 would be 184. There you go. How about the next one? That's 7 dimes is 70 and 49 should be 119. How about the next one? That's 9 40s would be 360 and 9 should be 369. You gotta practice. You can make up your own, for goodness sake. You don't have to give, I don't have to give you sheets and sheets of this stuff. There's more of that stuff. Alright, 25 times 12 is 300. That's in 12 quarters, like in money, $3. Sometimes intuition pays off. Alright, let's go back to the basics. It never hurts. Someday your kid's gonna ask you, what does this mean? Well, this means, what it means is, how many 4s go into a 22? So it's really asking you, what's 22 divided by 4? This is 22 divided by 4. It's not 4 divided by 22. So there's the answer. So if you had 22 marbles, and you had to break them into packets of 4 for a kid's birthday party or something, wouldn't you get 5 packages of 4? Or 5 bunches of 4? And there'd be, how many left over? You'd have 5 bunches of 4, and there'd be 2 left over. See, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 packages and 2 left over. So you could say there's 5 packages of 4 and there's still 2 left over that we got to share amongst 4 kids at the birthday party. So each kid gets half a marble, right? 2 parts of 2 quarters of a marble is the same as 1 half of a marble. Or you could just hide the 2 leftovers and pretend they're not there. That way you don't have a fight about splitting up the marbles into halves. There's how you do 22 divided by 4. Alright, let's animate this one. There's 3 ways to show dividing. Let's draw the marbles. I haven't lost my marbles yet. Looks to me like there's 4 packets of 6 and there's 5 left over. So we call that 4 with a remainder of 5. Or you could call it 4 and the 5 still have to be divided by 6. So 4 and 5/6 is the answer. you're going to find it's a lot easier in fractions than decimals. Decimals are ugly. Oh, computer just blew up. Come on. Engage. There we go. So let's try it now using decimals. Notice here how nice it is. You get 4 with 5 left over. I mean, that's pretty easy to understand. So there's 4 and you get 5 that you still got to share amongst 6 people. Isn't that pretty easy to picture? Now do it as decimals. Oh my goodness. If you do it as long division, you get one of these hokey decimal numbers. Oh, you'll find I don't even allow decimals in pre-calculus. That's just crazy. Look how you get that repeating pattern. It's just going to be, after a while, you just keep getting 20 as a remainder. 20, 20, 20, 20, 20, 20. So obviously, your answer is going to have tree, 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 tree. It ends up being 4.83, and the threes go on and on forever. All right? Just like wife goes on and on forever. Whoa, don't tell my woman that. All right, next slide. How many 4.3s go into a 30? In other words, what's 30 divided by 4.3? Or I draw you a pretty little picture there. Let's just animate this, all right? Animate. 30 divided by 4.3. Well, draw it on a number line. Here's 30. There's a length of 30. And now let's draw a length of 4. You could do this with a ruler if you wanted. There's a length of 4.3. How many 4.3 squeeze into 30? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and almost all 7 of them. That's what dividing is. How many chunks of 4.3 can you take out of 30? Well, you could do it with a ruler and draw really accurate like I've done here on this number line. Or you could just do the simple dividing technique. It's called an algorithm that we use. Okay, let's animate to engage. Okay, just about done here. Well, this is a quick video. Good. Here's what you're supposed to do. And after a while, you get a repeating pattern of zeros in the decimal. So after a while, you get tired of zero hundredths and zero thousandths and zero ten thousandths, so you quit writing them. So the answer's 6.97. It's ugly. When you do this one, I didn't do the actual dividing all the way here. It was going to be ugly. It was going to take forever. It turns out it was pretty easy to see the answer 6 and 42 43rds. But you'll learn this later. But if you try to do that as a decimal, here's the answer if you try to do it all the way as a decimal. All right, here's the answer as a decimal. Oops, did I mess that up? Yeah. No, okay, so I was just trying to show you that 6 and 42 43rds is a lot smarter way to say it. Okay? Alright, and here was a word problem that we did. 6 people estimate their expenses, their sharing car rides, I guess. So let's animate, engage. So here was the problem. 6 people sharing. And of course, the reason we do math is to solve real problems. It's not because of the fun of the abstract. So don't skip word problems, goodness. So 6 people are sharing a car ride, $54. How much does each person pay? All right, so you could do this. All right, everybody throw in a buck. All right, everybody throw in another buck. Right, so there's 6 people. They threw in 1 buck on the first line. Everybody throws in another buck each, so that's 6 bucks in the pot on the second line. Now they throw in another 6 buck each, so now they've thrown in 3 bucks each, so that's 18. And now they throw in 1 more buck each, so now they've thrown in 4 bunches of 6 is 24. So they can't do that. You could just carry around a bucket full of pebbles and break things into packages of 6 to find out how many bunches of 6 you have to make to get 54. Or you could learn your times table. Okay, so it's called dividing. You're just seeing how many packets of 6 you can take out of 54. All right, so everybody threw in a buck, a buck, a buck. Everybody threw in another buck, and the 6 people threw in another buck, and all 6 threw in another buck, all 6 threw in another buck. So how many times did six people each throw in the buck? Sounds to me like 9 sixes is 54. Gee, dividing is really like multiplying, but unmultiplying, funny enough. Isn't that weird? Well, it is. Multiplying and dividing are really just thinking backwards. Next slide. Engage. What's the final... Oh, okay, we're back to this one. What's the final answer for this? How many 4.3s go into 30? What is 30 divided by 4.3? Now, if you try it on a calculator, look what it says. 6.97674.4186. And your calculator stops because it's stupid. Right? It doesn't give you the exact answer. But if you go to your Windows calculator, look at the number you get. That's 6.97674.4186, whatever it is. But notice it starts to repeat at 97674.4186. So you'll find that any time you divide two decimal numbers, or whole numbers, that you end up with a repeating pattern in the decimal. Eventually, you have to have a repeating pattern. All right? There are numbers like pi that don't have a repeating pattern, but that's getting pretty advanced. The fact remains is you will always, always, somewhere along the line, when you're doing the long division, you'll come up to the same remainder on one of the lines, so eventually you'll end up repeating the decimal part. Kind of neat, eh? Okay, so let's try place values. We had to go back just to remind people what place values were. You would have done this in literacy. If you see the number 2317, that means you've got 2,000s, 300s, 110, and 7 ones. And we pronounce that 2,317. If you've got 4.6.53, well, the first digit after the decimal is called your tenths, and the next digit after that, two places to the right, is called your hundredths, because a tenth of a tenth is a hundredth. So that second number there is pronounced 46.53/100. You're not really supposed to say 0.53, but I'll learn you, don't worry. And the next number there is 91.38/100, because that is really 9 tens, 1 1, 3 tenths, and 8 one-hundredths. Okay. So there's your place values as they regard decimals. Next slide. Another one. What's 34.5 divided by 3.245? Make sure you know how to read these things. How many 3.245s can you squeeze into a 34.5? I'm drawing it for you. Right? You can do this with a ruler, or a sharp pencil, or sticks, or pebbles. They'd all have to be the same size pebbles. There's 34.5. A length of 34.5. So how many of those little purple 3.245s would you squeeze into a 34.5? Looks to me like it's going to be about 10-ish. Maybe even 11. I don't know, 8 or 9, 10, something like that. You know the answer somewhere around there. How many can you squeeze in? Well, if you round it, how many 3s would go into 30? About 10. So I'm somewhere around 10, we're thinking. Maybe 8, maybe 9, who knows. All right, let's do the math. Okay, well, it ends up being, well, let's do the math. I'll animate it for you. Here it comes. You know how to do this. We're going to move that decimal point eventually, because we don't know our 3.245 times tables. So we don't know how to divide by 3.245 easily in our head. So we're going to turn it into a 3245 by moving the decimal point three places to the right. And we're going to do the same thing to the 34.5. It's going to have the decimal point moved three places to the right. So here's how it works. The divisor gets multiplied by 1,000. The dividend gets multiplied by 1,000. We've turned it into something simple. Now you do the regular dividing trick, algorithm, method. And of course, it's ugly, I know. Look at this. Ugh. Oh man, you get 10.63 and you're still not done. You need more paper. Oh my god, the answer ends up being 10.63174114. You'd have to keep going, but eventually the pattern would repeat. It really would. Wouldn't it have been easier just to stay as a fraction or something? Okay, here we go. And the last slide. Nice. Okay, so here's another example of your decimal division. I'll just animate it. And it's always nice to have an estimate as to what your answer is going to be. I mean, how many nickels go into a dime? How many fives go into 11? Isn't it going to be like close to 2? If you don't get 2 as the final answer, then you know you messed it up. So of course you turn that 5.2 into a 52, you turn the 11.622 into 116 by moving the decimal point one place to the right. That means you multiplied the both by 10. You made the problem 10 times bigger, you magnified it. Let's have a boo here, race through this. Then you'll find that you end up with a slightly tidier answer here. Okay, so yeah. You'll find that you eventually end up, if you did this the long way, you eventually end up repeating you end up with a remainder of 0 eventually, which means that it's going to be a number that doesn't have a whole bunch of repeating parts to it. It's just going to go 2.235, and then it's going to be a whack of 0000000, which of course you don't bother writing. So technically it is a repeating decimal, it's just we don't bother writing the repeating zeros. So some of that's advanced with the repeating stuff, but maybe you'll see when you do this that it does get kind of ugly. That's enough of that stuff. Let's conclude this briefing.